today is found in the Gospel of Luke chapter 1, and I shall read verses 46 through 55. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever." One of the wonderful things about Christmas is its music. I love all the Christmas songs, both secular and spiritual. The hymns that we sang at the start of this worship, "Silent Night," "Hark the Herald Angels Sing," "Joy to the World," these are intensely spiritual carols that make our souls soar up and commune with God. Whereas jingle bells, deck the halls, silver bells, "I'll be home for Christmas," these are secular songs. And I love them too, because they add to my happiness. Because this is the season of joy. The spirit of Christmas is joy. And all these secular songs, Christmas songs, radiate that joy or intensify our experience of that joy. Now in Luke chapters 1 and 2, we have several songs recorded. These songs are sung by different people at different occasions. The one which is most familiar to us is the song which the angelic choir sang when they announced the birth of Christ to the angels of to the shepherds of Bethlehem as they were watching over their flocks by night. "Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill to men on whom God's favor rests." Chronologically, this is the last of the three songs that are recorded in the first two chapters of the Gospel of Luke. This song is preceded by Mary's song and by the song of Elizabeth. This morning, the focus of my study will be on Mary's song. And the scripture reading that I read are the words which Mary sang. In the Greek New Testament, these verses, Luke chapter 1, verses 46 through 55, are written in a poetic form. They have a special rhyme. There are some modern Bibles where the poetic sections of the Bible are printed in italics. So that's one way to differentiate between the poetic parts and from those that are written in regular prose. Mary's song consists of three stanzas. The first stanza is in verses 46 through 48. "My soul magnifies the Lord, and rejoices in God my Savior. Now, the verb to magnify means to glorify, to exalt. The Greek word is doxazo, and from this word is derived our English doxology. Doxology is an English word derived from the Greek. And in English we know that a doxology is a hymn of praise. Therefore, by calling Mary's song a doxology, we conclude that Mary's song is or was a hymn of praise. This is a burst of jubilant praise coming out from a grateful heart. Mary glorified God by proclaiming his goodness. In verse 48, she gives us the reason for her exuberant joy. Why is she rejoicing? Because she says, the Lord has been mindful of my humble state and has done great things for me. She referred to herself as God's servant. She considered herself unworthy to be the object of God's special favor, but she acknowledged the blessedness that has been bestowed upon her. She recognized the honor that was extended to her by saying, all generations of mankind shall call me blessed. So it's not wrong for us evangelical Christians to refer to Mary as the Blessed Virgin, because that's what the Bible calls her. She is blessed in all generations of mankind. And you see, from Mary's experience, God does not work in abstract. God's work is not theoretical. God's work is not abstract. God's work is real and personal. She says, God took notice of my humble estate. She was a very humble person. She lived in a tiny village. Nazareth at that time was a tiny village, a very obscure place in Israel. And the town was notorious, had acquired a bad fame. She lived in a poor family. She was a peasant girl. She was not highly educated. Her education did not go beyond the elementary school level. She was just 16, barely 16 years old when the angel Gabriel told her that God had chosen her to be the vehicle of bringing his son to this world. So she came from a poor family and she was engaged to a carpenter. So you can see that she came from a humble state. And God picked her up, chose her. She won the favor of God because of her faith and purity. And God elevated her to the position of being the mother of the Messiah. So you can see how God works with us individually, personally. And he takes notice of everything we do. Nothing we do escapes God's eyes. Now in the second stanza, she expands the song from the personal to the corporate. Look at what she says in verse 50. God extends his mercy to all who fear him. In the Greek Bible, it doesn't say God extends his mercy to those who fear him. It says God extends his mercy to all who honor him. So replace fear with honor or respect. God extends his mercy to all who honor him and respect. Not the Apostle John tells us there is no fear in love. Fear, love casts out of all fear. God loves us, and he showed his love by sending his Son to this world to dwell among us, to show us how to live and how to approach God. And then he loved us when we were sinners. And in response, we loved him because he first loved us. So the relationship between us and God is based on love. And in real love, there's no fear. So the word fear in our English Bibles is in some modern translations, fear is replaced by honor or respect. And that's the correct rendition of the Greek. God extends his mercy to all those who honor him and who respect him. Mary honored God by submitting herself to his will. Remember when the angel Gabriel appeared to her and told her that God had chosen her to give birth to his son? She said, "Let it be according to your word." She submitted herself to God's plan. And this submission came without any reservations. In contrast, I want you to look at the response of Zechariah. Now, Zechariah was a priest. And while he was performing his priestly duties at the temple in Jerusalem, the same angel Gabriel broke good news to him. He told him that his wife Elizabeth will bear him a son, and they'll call his name John. And Zechariah could not believe what the angel had told him, because both he and his wife were advanced in age. His wife was 70 years old. And he couldn't believe that a 70-year-old woman could give birth to a son. So he did not believe the angel's message. And because of his unbelief, he lost his ability to speak. And he did not recover his speech until after the birth of his son, John the Baptist. Now, when you contrast Mary with Zechariah, you can see the vast difference. Now, Zechariah was an elderly priest, and Mary was a young girl . But she responded to God in a positive. She honored God by submitting to his will. Zechariah did not do that. Now, in the second stanza, when she says God extends his mercy to all those who honor him, she also says, God scattered the proud in their thoughts. God scattered the proud in their thoughts. I wanted to know what this really meant. So when I consulted the Greek New Testament, I found a clearer meaning. It says God frustrates the plans of the proud and the arrogant. He did so at the Tower of Babel. You know, he frustrated the plans of the builders of the Tower of Babel, because that was not according to his will. So whenever we embark on a work that does not harmonize with God's will, he frustrates those plans. So if you have planned something and it doesn't work out, consider that to be a blessing in disguise. God frustrated maybe because your plan was not in harmony with his will. And look for another plan that God has for you. Then in the second stanza, she keeps saying that God brought down rulers. In other words, God dethroned some kings and he elevated others, elevated the humble, but he brought down some kings, dethroned them. Well, think of Saul, the first king of Israel. God chose Saul to be the first king of Israel. But when Saul disobeyed God and worked contrary to God's will and plan, God rejected him. And God sent Samuel to anoint David as a king in place of Saul when Saul was still alive. This was a sign to tell Saul that he was rejected by God. God no longer recognized him to be the king over Israel. Eventually, we know that Saul was killed in a battle with the Philistines on the hill of Gilboa. Think also of Nebuchadnezzar. One day we're told that Nebuchadnezzar went on the roof of his palace. He surveyed the skyline of Babylon and he said, "Isn't this Babylon the great that I have built?" He became puffed up, proud and arrogant. "This marvelous metropolis I built with my own power, because of my intelligence and might and strength and wealth." He took all the credit to himself and God brought him down. He was stricken with a mental illness and was unable to govern. You see, here are some examples from history that shows what Mary said is right. God brought down rulers from their thrones and lifted up the humble. Think of King Cyrus, the founder of the Persian Empire. In Isaiah chapter 45, verses 1 through 8, we have some information about Cyrus. God calls Cyrus my servant. King Cyrus of Persia, who was a Zoroastrian, by the way, God calls him my servant. Why? Because what he did was in tune with God's plan. And if you read Isaiah 45 verses 1 through 8, you find God tells Cyrus that he opened doors before him. He subdued kings. He enabled him to subdue nations. He enabled Cyrus to strip kings of their armor. And all this was done because God was upholding him. So, what Mary says in her song, in the second stanza of her song, is correct. Now we come to the third stanza of Mary's song, which is found in verse 54. There she says, God has kept his promises, his covenantal promises, the promises that he had made through a covenant with Abraham. In Genesis chapter 18, verse 18, we have the exact wording of God's covenantal promise to Abraham. All nations of the earth would be blessed through Abraham's seed. This is the promise God made to Abraham, that through his seed, all the nations of the world would be blessed and God would make him the father of many nations. It's interesting to notice that in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 1, the evangelist Matthew traces Jesus' lineage to David, to King David, and then from King David all the way back to Abraham. So Matthew tells us that Jesus was the son of David, the son of Abraham. And Jesus, therefore, is the seed of Abraham. And it's through Jesus that the nations of the world were blessed. Did Abraham become the father of many nations? Yeah, Abraham is not only the father of the Jews, he's the father of all those who believe in Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul makes this crystal clear in Galatians chapter 3. He says, all those who believe in Christ are Abraham's children and heirs according to the promise that God had made to Abraham. So every one of us is a son and daughter of Abraham. All the Christian nations are the children of Abraham. So Abraham has become the father of many nations. God's word does not fail. So Mary was able to see how God's purposes, how God's redemptive purpose was fulfilled in the history of Israel and in her own life experience. Mary's focus was not on her immediate blessedness for being chosen by God to be the mother of the Messiah, but her focus was on the ultimate outcome of the Messiah's coming into this world. She looked at the long range, not the short term. And it's also interesting to notice that she never mentions the law of Moses in her song. She only refers to the Abrahamic covenant. She refers to the covenant that God made with Abraham, and she never mentions the law of Moses. She was unlike the scribes and the Pharisees. Whenever the scribes and Pharisees referred to an incident or an event, they put it within the framework of the law of Moses. Now Mary did not put her experience within the framework of the law of Moses. She made it to be a part of God's covenant with Abraham. And that's a big difference. The greatest newspaper publisher in the early 20th century was William Randolph Hearst. He was a patron of art. He spent a lot of time and money collecting precious works of art. One day, he read in a magazine the description of an artwork that he felt he had to own. So he sent his agents throughout the world looking for that special artwork. After searching for 6 months, his agents returned empty-handed. But they discovered an amazing information. His agents found out that that special artwork which William Randolph Hearst was looking for was nearby. It was in one of his warehouses. He had purchased this artwork a long time ago and kept it in its crate. So he had been searching for a treasure which he already had, but he didn't realize that he had it. And my friends, this is the condition of many Christians today. This is the condition of many of our contemporaries. They're looking for wisdom, joy, peace, fulfillment, the meaning of life, but they're searching in the wrong places. They're looking for these blessedness in Eastern mysticism, in Scientology, in the occult, in materialism, and lately in Kabbalah. Kabbalah has been revived. It's a big industry today. I don't know if you've heard of Kabbalah. Kabbalah was a philosophy of life invented by Jewish rabbis in the Middle Ages. And it was dormant for 5 centuries. It's been revived recently. Several rabbis in Israel revived Kabbalah, and it's a big business today. those rabbis had become billionaires today. And every year they have a Kabbalah convention in Tel Aviv, and people come from all over the world. Now, let me explain to you what Kabbalah is, briefly. The rabbis who invented Kabbalah claim that every word in the Old Testament has four meanings. One is a literal meaning, the other one is a symbolic meaning, the third one is the rabbinical interpretation given to that word, and the fourth, they claim, is a mystical, esoterical meaning, which only they knew. And so, they take every word from the Old Testament and ascribe to it a mystical, esoteric meaning. And people are searching for this esoteric, mystical meaning in Kabbalah. They're paying thousands of dollars to get those mystical, esoteric interpretations and to apply them to their life. They think that's the way of finding fulfillment. That's the way of finding the meaning of life. These are, in the words of Jeremiah the prophet, cisterns that have cracked, that have cracks in them. Now, in ancient times, cisterns were used to collect rainwater. The Middle East is semi-arid, and every society, in biblical times, even today, have cisterns to collect rainwater. Now, Jeremiah likens all worldly philosophies to cisterns that have cracks in them. A cistern that has cracks in it cannot hold water. The water seeps through the cracks and gets lost. So these Scientology, mysticism, Eastern mysticism, Kabbalah, all these are cracked cisterns. They don't satisfy the yearnings of the human soul. The only person who can satisfy the yearnings of our soul, the only person who can help us comprehend the real meaning of life, the only person who can give us real joy, peace, and fulfillment is Jesus Christ, who was born in the stable of Bethlehem.
Amen.
There was no other who was a human child, but at the same time, a divine son. There was no other who was the savior of sinners, and yet he was crucified by sinners. There was no other who is the judge of the world, and yet he was dragged from, as a felon, from one human court to another. There was no other who was wounded by Satan, but who was able to crush Satan. There was no other who is the King of Glory, but he chose to wear no other crown except the crown of thorns. And he did it because he loved us. He left the glories of heaven and came to this sin-cursed world to seek and save sinners like you and me, and to give his life as a ransom for our salvation. He came from heaven to earth because he loved us. And then he died on the cross and stayed on the cross because he loved us. So during this Christmas day, let's resolve that we respond to this amazing love of our Lord Jesus Christ by surrendering ourselves to him, by honoring him, by yielding to his will, and try to be in tune with him all the time. Christ in you is the hope of glory.